أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله سيد المرسلين وخاتم النبيين ورحمة للعالمين وصلى الله على آله الطاهرين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا أوصيكم عباد الله ونفسي بتقوى الله. Every year I actually begin this Friday's khutbah by saying that it is indeed a very good Friday for us. I think after Eid, this is the crowd we get on the Friday prayers. Since this is the month of Ramadan, I wanted to revisit one of the important issues about the essential purpose of fasting. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Baqarah, ayat number 183, where he begins this section on the fasting of the month of Ramadan, the very first ayat where he commands us, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu kutiba alaykum as-siyam, that all you who believe, fasting has been made wajib on you. And he ends with two words at the end of that ayat. And those two words are actually the soul of fasting. Why? لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. The word لَعَلَّ is used in Arabic many times by the writer or the speaker with the expectation that the audience will hopefully do this. So Allah says, I have made this wajib on you, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. Hopefully you will acquire taqwa. And taqwa basically means this power of resisting the temptation to commit sins by keeping the presence of Allah in our life, in our consciousness. That is the essence of taqwa, because when we have this consciousness of His being in our life, that becomes the most powerful tool to prevent ourselves from committing sins. And that's why you will see that part of the rulings and the things that we don't do during the fasting, because fasting is not really an action. You can't really show to anyone that you are fasting. And so the things which are forbidden in fasting, most of those items in the list you will see, either they do, they have to do with food and drink, or, you know, sexual desires. When it comes to food and drinks, alhamdulillah, you know, at least for us here in Toronto, you know, there's no issue as far as the halal meat is concerned. And so it's not that much of a challenge. But the challenge is there when it comes to the issue of consumption of alcohol. And I don't mean to say that it is common among the Muslims, but it is a challenge because it is all around in the society. And we see, you know, from time to time, so many studies have come by different groups, from medical and, you know, scientific organizations all the way to World Health Organization. And sometimes, you know, we are told that too much is very bad for you. A little bit is okay. All these people, when they talk about, you know, health of your heart, they say, look at the Mediterranean diet, you know, red wine is good. Little bit of it, you know, will be good. And this is where we see that again and again, the credible, you know, scientific and health organization have always come and said, that is just propaganda. And even recently, you know, Dr. Marine Piano, who is of the Department of the Nursing at Vanderbilt University, you know, the statement which comes from this, professor, that there has been a lot of recent evidence that has really challenged the notion of any kind of what we call cardioprotective or healthy effects of alcohol. And then they're very clear that even small amounts of alcohol have health consequences. And let me, also tell you that on the Muslim side, there are some very fringe elements. You know, there was a mufti, not a really high-ranking scholar, but in Egypt, he said, well, you know, hurmat is when you become intoxicated. So a little bit of it would be okay. You know, so this new kind of ijtihad is always there. So it's not only these groups out there. So when we look at the scientific side, even recently, Dr. Tim Naimi, who is director of the University of Victoria's Canadian Institute for Substance Use Research, like here locally, he says alcohol is harmful to the health starting from very low levels. Scientists believe that the many ways that alcohol creates health issues is by damaging the DNA. And it fundamentally affects the DNA, and that's why it affects so many organ systems. And so this is where, we go back to what Islam has been saying from day one. You know, Quran talks about it. Quran actually has clearly forbidden as when it comes to khamr and intoxicating drinks and a substance. And when it comes to science also, again and again we see, the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prevail against all this propaganda which are going against the teachings of Quran. Salawat man akbarar. So that's one side of the purpose of fasting, to control our desire for food and drink. And of course it is wajib, you can't just be without food and drink, but you have to consume it according to the laws that we have from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It has to be halal and tayyib, halal and good. The other side of fasting, as far as the purpose is concerned, is this issue of handling our own sexuality. You know, this indictment of the former U.S. President Trump is a prime example of how this society is really going on the wrong path. You know, in the last 20 years or so, anything which will be a barrier from going in that sinful act is being removed. Everything is becoming, permissible and okay. And even if you look at this case against President Donald Trump, the irony is that the case is not that the president indulged with, illicit relationship with a adult, actress. The case is actually that he paid $130,000 to buy the silence of that woman just 12 days before the elections that he had in 2016. It was the payment which became an issue for the society. And that is the issue, because the money was paid by the lawyer, and then there is a trace of the money coming from Trump to the lawyer, labeled as legal fees, but the same amount exactly. And that's where the issue of fraud is coming in. And so, and this is not first time, especially in the current American history. Remember the example of Bill Clinton, and that there also the whole discussion was to how do you define what is sexual activity, whether it took place or not, this is where we had to realize that these are issues that Islam does not shy away from talking about human challenges and problems. And this is where, after all these studies are done time and again, we see that the wisdom of Islam shines through, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wa kalimatullah hiya al-uliya. The word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always prevails. Salawat upon Iqbalah. Coming back to the issue of, fasting and connecting this with this issue, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam, he says fasting is not only the issue of fasting, you know, refraining from food and drink. He says very clearly, even your eyes should fast. Your ears should fast. Your hands should fast. Your feet should fast. Now, these are not on the fiqh level. This is on the akhlaqi level. But he's connecting this with the purpose of fasting. And this is where we see when we look at all these challenges, and it prevails all across the society, in all societies, including Muslims. You know, whether you're looking at the, White House, or you're looking at the church in Boston with a bishop, or you're talking about a mullah in a madrasa. You know, these issues prevail all over when it comes to these, you know, temptations. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very clear about this issue in Quran. When he talks about this issue of decency, the very first thing, 60 Imam said, remember, even your eyes has to fast. That is the training for it. The first command on the issue of, you know, hijab is addressed to the men and then to the women. And the first hijab is the hijab of eyes. You know, probably this relates more to men than women. And we totally, forget this issue. And this is where we see in the Quran, you know, in most cases, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he says, don't do this, this is haram, this is bad, he just gives the command clearly, don't do this. Certain, you know, issues he has picked up, and he uses the term, la taqrabu. What does that mean? Don't even go close to it. He's not saying, don't do it. He says, la taqrabu, do not even go close to it. In Surah number 6, ayat 151, Surah 17, ayat 32, in the first one, he talks about, you know, immorality in general. Second one, he talks about indecency on a sexual level. And he's very clear when he says, la taqrabu. Means do not even go put yourself into a situation or, you know, in an environment or even with the groups where you will be pushed into acts of indecency. And this is where we have to realize that when we talk about fasting, it is not only refraining from food and drink, you know, it is really the fast of our entire body, including when it comes to the issue of eyes. And this is where the words at the end of that very first ayat on the passage of fasting, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, becomes relevant. And here I would say that in Ramadan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it wajib. This is a spiritual training where it's obligatory for us to go through it. But looking at the purpose of it, and the need for it, you know, Islam recommends that even during the other months, there are at least 3 days in every Islamic month where it is recommended to fast. So that whatever, you know, energy you required, the power and the strength that you required, known as taqwa, during the, month of Ramadan, you know, those 3 days will recharge your soul and your spirit. And then you'll be able to maintain that, you know, momentum, inshallah, till we come towards the next season of spirituality. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to understand the wisdom of fasting and to fulfill our duties in the best of manner. Inna ahsan al-hadith kitabullah al-aziz, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wal asr inna al-insana la fi khusr. إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحليم الكريم غافر الذنب وقابل التوب وهو الغفور الرحيم ونشهد أن لا إله إلا هو العثوف للعباد بجوده والعواد على المذنبين بحلمه ونشهد أن محمدا نبيه وحبيبه سيد المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين ورحمة للعالمين صلى الله عليه وآله الداعين إلى سبيل الله بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة قادة الأمم وأولياء النعمة ومعدن الرحمة أوصيكم عباد الله بالتوبة ما سلف من ذنوبكم. We are already into the half of the month of Ramadan, coming closer to the Layali al-Qadr, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to understand and get in touch with this special nights in the best of manner. These days of the month of Ramadan coincide with the Christian event of Good Friday and the Jewish event of Passover. And the expectation would have been there that during this week there will be peace and tranquility, especially when it comes to Jerusalem, which is a holy city respected by all followers of Ibrahim alayhi salam. But we see that the Israeli forces once again raided the Al-Aqsa Mosque, you know, brutally hitting men and women who had gathered there for dawn prayers. Even if you look at the videos, they're all down. Nobody is standing up and resisting anything. And they're just hitting them with their baton, you know, whatever they had at that time. And the Western leaders, you know, these days, Ukraine war is the main thing. It has become like a smoke screen for them, that the suffering of the Palestinians is not really coming up to the radar. Last week, you know, Israel's finance minister actually made a statement where he says there is no such thing as a Palestinian nation. There is no Palestinian history. There is no Palestinian language. It's totally even denying the existence of the people known as Palestinians. And if anyone made such a statement about the state of Israel, immediately the card of anti-Semitism will be brought forth. And even, you know, legal actions will be taken by the person who makes those kind of remarks. You know, and this is where, when it comes to, you know, an Israeli minister saying those things, of course, there have been some condemnation here and there in the Western, you know, parliaments, but not really that seriously. It is just a, you know, lip service. And so while we sit down in the month of Ramadan and recite this famous dua of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I talked about the commentary of that on the first Friday khutbah of this month of Ramadan. Remember the words, Allahumma farrij an kulli makroob, Allahumma rudda kulla ghareeb, Allahumma fukka kulla asir. You know, when you are praying for the distressed people, when you are praying for those who are displaced, those who have been, you know, innocently put in prison. This is the time that we have to see, is there something that we can do? And the least that we can do is, you know, go to the website of NCCM, National Council of Canadian Muslims, add your voice to the letter that they have prepared for the Prime Minister. You know, you can just put in your name and then it will generate, it will automatically generate and then send that on your behalf. Although the Prime Minister and some other ministers and MPs have actually spoken about what happened just a few days ago in Al-Aqsa Mosque, especially about the rhetoric of the Israeli government and the actions of the government, but it's important for us to, you know, keep up the pressure. There is a question whether they are sincere or not. You know, at least they spoke. And that is something we have to keep in mind, and the pressure has to be there. We cannot just be silent and let it go, or just be appeased with the words which are coming out on this incident. And that is where we'll be at least partially be fulfilling our prayer at dua when we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allahumma farrij an kulli makroob, Allahumma rudd kull ghareeb, Allahumma fukk kull asir. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hasten the appearance of the imam so that we can have global peace, inshallah. اللهم صل على سيد المرسلين وشفي المذنبين نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم وعلى إمام المتقين وعمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب صلوات الله عليه وعلى سيدة نساء العالمين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها وعلى سيد الشباب أهل الجنة الحسن المجتبى والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء عليهم الصلاة والسلام اللهم صل على أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي عليهم الصلاة والسلام اللهم صل على مولانا الحجة بن الحسن صاحب العصر والزمان ما أحيى أسار البدء وتغيان هذه بأمنية الشرك والنفاق حاسد فر البغي والشقاق صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آباء الكرام ما اتصلت الليالي والأيام اللهم عجل فرجه وسهل مخرجه واكحل ناظرنا بنظرة منا إليه واجعلنا من المستشهدين بين يديه اللهم اجعلنا ممن يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى إن الله يعمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون